For the 37th time, dating back to 1969, the ARCA stars prepare to assault the unpredictable high banks of Talladega Superspeedway. Today, last year's leading rookie and this year's leading winner, Bill Baird, will realize a dream as he officially becomes the 1999 ARCA Series National Champion. Perhaps no one understands Baird's emotions better than this three-time titleist, Tim Steele, whose series record 20 Superspeedway wins include four here at Talladega. It's an ARCA battle on the high banks next. Speed Road coverage comes to you today from the world's fastest stock car facility, Talladega Super Speedway. It's the 17th running of the ARCA Bondo Mar-Hyde Winn-Dixie 300. And the very first order of business will be to crown a champion. How about 50-year-old Sturgis, Kentucky driver Bill Baird? He becomes the 1999 ARCA champion in only his second season by rolling off today. How about a sophomore season driver becoming a champion? Other ARCA surprises in 1999? Well, there are plenty. With more on that, here's Ray Dunlap.
Well, Doc, in 1999, there have been 19 different races in the ARCA Bondo Mar-Hyde Series and 11 different winners. But the amazing stat is that seven of those winners got their first career victory ever. One of those was Bobby Gerhart back in Daytona. The other, Bill Baird, who won for the first time at Atlanta Motor Speedway. This 50-year-old father of two has posted five wins this season, along the way with 14 top five finishes. And today his efforts are rewarded with the championship. Now this may be the best field of cars we've ever seen at Talladega for this division, and the front row represents a lot of great drivers. Bob Strait and Tim Steele have 48 career wins. Steele has won the last three races here at Talladega, all of those coming from the pole position. But on Thursday afternoon, Bob Strait won the pole and put Steele on the outside. Strait is a 14-time winner in this series, but he's never won on a track bigger than 1 mile. Today, we will shine the spotlight on the number 66 team, and Bob Strait hopes that sunshine points his way to victory lane. For more, let's go to Bill Weber.
Well, this is ARCA's biggest track, and I would say this is their biggest race. It's certainly their longest race of the 1999 season. But with the TV cameras on and the Winston Cup garage watching, everyone is feeling the pressure to perform. It's more than just win. You want to show off here today. Now, there are 38 drivers in this field that have a chance to be two champions. Bill Baird clinches the 99 title when he rolls off. Frank Kimmel is the current champ. He's second in points and seventh on the grid. He has Hendrick horsepower under the hood and high hopes for a high finish in this race. Kevin Harvick ran the Craftsman Truck Race Friday night, but flew here Friday morning to practice his car. This is a Richard Childress Winston Cup car that Mike Skinner drove to a pair of poles at Daytona in 1997. Harvick also has Childress power. He has to start at the back of the pack because Mike Dillon qualified the car. He should be able to get to the front. We'll see if he can. And starting eighth, the one person in this field who is certainly no gentleman. 34-year-old Shauna Robinson finished second at Daytona in February. If she wins today, Shauna gets the glory. But 57-year-old retired police officer Bill Shipley wins a $100,000 bonus.
And with just two events remaining, take a look at the point standings. No doubt who's going to become the champion, but other spots within that top 10 could shuffle in these final two events. Hello, everyone. I'm Jerry Punch, along with Benny Parsons and Kyle Petty. Glad to have you with us. And guys, I'm told that when a crew chief talks to a driver about racing Talladega, it's like he's training a dog. He uses the word stay a lot. Stay in line, stay out of trouble, and stay there until it's over.
That's definitely so. You know, I've run here 9 million times, it seems like. And there's been races where I just go high and I stay high, or I go low and I stay low. I definitely listen to what the spotter says. Sometimes your line goes to the back, sometimes your line shuffles you to the front. But if you're patient, you can come out of here with something.
And that's something some young drivers have to learn today, is patience. And that's exactly why they're here at Talladega, getting ready for the year 2000 in the NASCAR Busch Series. As we see the starting lineup, we go back to 14th spot. We saw Kevin Harvick just a moment ago. He will drive for Richard Childress on the NASCAR Busch Series in the year 2000. But he's got to get some experience at Daytona Talladega. As we look at 16 through 30, back in the 19th spot, Anthony Lazarro. He will be driving the McDonald's Busch car in the year 2000, but he has to get some experience on a big track. Otherwise, NASCAR will not allow him to run in Daytona in February. Also, Dave Steele back in 22nd spot. He will be driving the NASCAR Busch Series car for the Felix Sabata's team next year. He also has to give some experience on these racetracks if he expects to compete in 2000.
And there's a look at the 40 starters today. 52 cars came here to attempt to qualify. Only 40 will start for 300 miles at Talladega. When we come back, we'll wave the green flag at the world's fastest stock car facility. Our Speedroll coverage of ARCA Bondo Mar-Hyde competition from Talladega is being brought to you by EA Sports and NASCAR 2000. If it's in the game, it's in the game. What a day for racing here in Talladega, Alabama. This racetrack almost doesn't need describing. It's a four-syllable word that means speed. You simply say Talladega.
But we'll try. It's 2.66 miles in length. It's a trioval. The front stretch, 4,300 feet. Back stretch is 4,000 feet. In the corners, banking of 33 degrees. In the trioval, 18 degrees. The straightaways are banked 2 degrees, just enough for water to roll off. And Kyle, going into these 33-degree banks at speed 190 miles per hour, it really doesn't appear as they have any banking at all.
No, once you get in the corner at the speed that these guys are running, it feels like you're on a flat racetrack. The only difference you feel is your head wants to sling to the other side of the car in a 33-degree bank at 180 or 90 miles an hour, but it really feels pretty flat.
We'll have five in-car cameras today. We'll ride along initially. We'll go to the car number 46, last year's champion, Frank Kimmel, the Advanced Auto Parts Chevrolet, which will start back in seventh spot. Benny?
Starting in sixth is C.W. Smith. Skip Smith, he starts sixth in the shop back onboard camera. Bobby Gearhart, the key waiting on Casino's camera, will be starting in the fifth spot. And on the pole, the ARCA Bondo Mar-Hyde camera along with Bob Strait.
We get set for the green flag. Hank Wetzel will wave the green flag here. It's the 17th time the ARCA cars have run the Winn-Dixie 300 here in the fall. It is their next to last event. Their last race will be coming up in Atlanta, Georgia, the Georgia Boot 400 on November 20th. And we'll be there to cover the action. They just joined us, a champion crown today. 50-year-old Bill Baird, by rolling off at the start, becomes a 1999 ARCA champion.
They will slowly come down to the start-finish line where Wetzel will throw the green flag. And we'll see these cars up speeds up to 195 miles per hour. And folks, you're not going to believe how close they run together at that speed.
No time to take his car toward the front.
Frank Kimmel, the Advanced Auto Parts onboard camera, right in the middle of this. We see him back in about eighth or ninth spot.
Got a great run and took the lead right going into the first corner.
There we see the 28 car. The white car on the outside is C.W. Skip Smith. We're riding along with Bob Strait, our pole sitter. That's now a battle for the third spot. And in red and white car, number one is Shauna Robinson, the Bob Evans Restors. The young lady finished second in Daytona, and she wins today, as Bill Weber told you, fans have walked off with $100,000.
Side here, and Jacati and Steele has kind of checked out about 10 or 12 car lengths. The deal is, once the cars get side by side here, unless they line up, it's tough to run down the front pack. These guys will get out a little bit, and eventually they'll run them back down, because this crowd will get But in the initial stages, nobody wants to give an inch. Nobody wants to get in line and race. They all want to lead this thing and go to the front.
Here's Skip Smith and our champion, Bill Baird. We're in seventh position. This is the Saturn Machine Speedy Pop onboard camera. Right now, he's battling for about the fifth spot. He is in the fifth spot.
Side by side for third position. If you take a look and ride along with Bill Baird, watching the battle in front of him. That is the pole sitter, Bob Strait, the 66 car. Alongside him is Matt Hutter. Hutter, who finished second in this race a year ago.
And Kyle, I'm really shocked these guys are able to keep up as well as they have, running side by side.
If you notice, when they get to the corner, the inside line right here goes ahead about a car length. He's got a little help this time because the car pulled down behind him. But he goes ahead a little bit ahead, and then the outside line pitches back up. Left two more guys to run side by side. And you'll notice that as the 66, he'll run down the first pack and catch up with him real quick. It is amazing that they haven't checked out any further than they've checked out with this pack running the way they're running two by two. It's a pretty strong field this year. A lot of times you come down here and you get five or six cars, eight or ten cars that can check out and just leave everybody. This time these guys aren't checking out with each other. They're running pretty good, pretty clean, and they're not getting away.
See Tim Steele trying to go for the lead. And finally, get
three cars single filed, and we have officially begun the Winn-Dixie 300. And this man is officially the 1999 ARCA Bondo Mar-Hyde Series champion, 50-year-old Sturgis, Kentucky driver Bill Baird, currently being shown in fourth spot. We'll be right back. Talladega Superspeedway. I'm Jerry Punch along with Kyle Petty, Benny Parsons, Ray Dunlap, and Bill Weber, as four cars are breaking away, and Tim Steele looking a little bit racy, but now, Benny, they're going to go two by two, it looks like.
And that will certainly hurt their chances of trying to pass the leader, Mike Cicchetti, in the teal-colored 17, and Matt Hutter still on that outside line, follows whoever moves up on the outside. Right now, it's the red 16 of Tim Steele.
To run with the lead pack here in a restrictor plate race. In the past, the equipment he's had at these restrictor plate races has not...
Okay, Bobby, I know you're running pretty good right now, but if we go jogging around, the whole pack don't catch us. Let's just ride there for a little while, okay?
Obviously, they're working with him. They want him to get in line so they can break away from the rest of the field. But the point is that Strait has not had a lot of time drafting with very fast and more talented drivers. That's something they worked on in happy hour here, something they've worked on throughout the week, and something they were concerned about here in the early stages of the race. So far for Bob, it's worked out fairly well. Now he's got to see if he can rope in those front three cars.
Take a look at the Midway Island Ford of Bob Strait. That is the Mark Thompson machine crash. Car number 19, that's Kevin Counts. We're going to spin it around. Thus far, no one else has contacted him.
Also, the 33 car, Joe Knott, is involved. There we see Joe Knott, the red white car, driving away from Lima, Ohio. And then we see Kevin Counts' 19 car sitting there. He fires it back up and seems to be driving away. Wow, how can all these cars spin around and not have any more damage than that? Never see Randall Ritter in the yellow number 31. Let's go back and see if we can see what might have caused this. Oh, they're on the bottom of the racetrack, right on the apron. Kirk Schumerding in the three car gets in the left rear quarter of the 19 of Kevin Counselor, and there the 31 car of Randall Ritter gets into the 33 of Joe Knott. And those cars spin down through there, and Kyle, I'm amazed, no more damage than that.
Yeah, if you watch this, the three, like you said, got into it. But look how wide the racetrack is. You know, the guys at Talladega came in here and put all this pavement out through here. And look, these cars begin to slow down. But these guys are able to drive around the accident, even though they're 60, 70 feet from the racetrack. But they're able to drive through the accident because the cars spin out of the way. They all keep going in the same direction. They all stay on all four tires. And you're able to avoid a little bit more. It could have been terrible.
And look at all this smoke. And all these cars go sliding. Now, if you're coming down through here, where do you choose where to go? Because there's nothing but smoke there. And everyone's trying to find some clean air they can drive. See how these guys are going all the way down to the left, trying to find to avoid because they can't see the cars and all the smoke.
First caution flag today coming out on lap number 8. An incident in the 12 with Kevin Kelfer, Randall Ritter, and Joe Knott. The three cars involved, all three minimal damage. Back with Green Flag Racing in just a moment. Back at Talladega Superspeedway, getting set for the restart after the first caution flag today coming out on lap number 8 involving three cars, Kevin Kelfer, Randall Ritter, and Joe Knott. Randall Ritter has taken his car number 31 behind the wall. The other two drivers have continued. We start here on lap number 13.
See Frank Kimmel down on the inside. And there's John Robinson as he goes by Bill Baird. Followed closely by Dan Pardis, I think, in the 42 car.
Danny Pardis has really made a charge for the front. He started back in 16th spot. He'd come all the way to fifth position for about a lap, and then got shuffled back in the draft. But this young man, I talked to him yesterday, they were disappointed in their qualifying position. Felt they would race much better, and obviously Jim Gardner's car, Benny, is running off the well here in the early laps.
It is, but now he's hung on the outside, and we see Frank Kimmel and Brian Ross. That's Ross in the golden white number 67. Swain Jr. behind the two cars, the Harley Ward Burton look like. It looks like Mike Swain Jr. goes down the inside. Looks like he's off the pace. Yes, he is.
Yeah, he just pulled over all of a sudden. He seemed to be drawing back on him a little bit, and then all of a sudden about to start finishing, he dove to the inside and got out of the way.
And there we see the 22 car off Mike Swain Jr. as he coasts down the backstretch.
That was the car they bought for Bill Davis about a week and a half ago. They have a Bill Davis Terry Ellage engine on board. And, of course, the young man hoping to run the full season possibly next year at ARCA. Won the ARCA race last November.
Now, Kiketti moves over, tries to block Tim Steele, Bob Strait, and Matt Hunter. Right now, these four cars, as you can see, have broken away a little bit from the fifth place car. Well, not much. 50. The 17 car Mike Giacchetti, folks, if you don't realize, he will be competing for the Rebestos Rookie of the Year in the year 2000 on the NASCAR Winch Cup Circuit. He'll be going up against Matt Kenseth and Dale Earnhardt Jr. driving his second car for Cale Yarbrough, teammate to Rick Mann.
Now Giacchetti will get a challenge.
High side, Mike. On high. Still there, Mike.
And Joe Knott.
Crosses out.
Joe Knott has crashed on the backstretch.
So the second caution flag today coming out on lap number 14. Joe Knott out of the ASA ranks spins around and has contact with the wall. Here is the battle back to the stripe among the lead cars.
And I'm not sure exactly.
Full range to the caution, Mike. But I was in front. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, what is their rule about racing back to the caution?
I don't think they race back to the line. I think that's what the spotter was telling Mike Giacchetti, that you don't race back to the line.
Yeah, that is the ARCA rule. Until the final 10 laps of the race, that's when you are allowed to protect your position. But besides that, they do not race back to the line. Here's the 33 car, Benny, just looping it around.
Yeah, and the left rear tire is flat. And I don't know that there's enough damage there to cause that tire to go flat. I would guess that's what caused the spin. That's something, he cut the tire down and it went flat as he came off the second corner and around he goes.
Yeah, if you go back to the accident that happened before this at the 33 that Joe Knott was involved in, he got clipped in the left rear right here in the trial when spun down through the infield. It could have been just a little bit of tire rub, and it doesn't take but a little bit for a couple of laps to wear through that the sidewall or to wear through the tread, and it'll turn around on you in a heartbeat, and that's what it looks like, that it just turned around on him.
Joe Knott, only his second start in ARCA. He ran Charlotte a few weeks ago, finished eighth up there, driving for Eddie Sharp, who was formerly the crew chief when the year began, for Bill Baird, the ARCA champion. And here's the accident Kyle's talking about at the very beginning of the race down on lap number 8.
You see these guys get together, the three gets into this car, but here's Joe Knott that gets hit in the left rear right here and spun back across. He got hit right behind the left rear tire. And then these guys come back across, and it doesn't really look like they get together too hard right there. But they end up going on down the highway and changing tires and coming back out a little later. Then three laps later, after the restart, when we go back and you have the restart, and here's Joe Knott spinning down the backstretch with a flat left rear, and it's like the left rear went flat, spun it around, backed it in the wall, and it's like Benny says. It doesn't really appear that there's enough damage there to have made the left rear go flat. It's obvious pretty much that it was flat whenever he spun.
All right, Randall Ritter is behind the wall, involved in that first incident, and Bill Weber is with me.
And Randall Ritter is finished for this day. An interesting story to tell, though. What happened out there?
Well, Bill, it's just racing, you know. It appeared to me that the car in front of me turned the other car there about the tri-oval. Wasn't much I could do. I made a pretty violent, evasive maneuver, and I cleared him. But I couldn't get my car back straightened out. Round it came, and then I got drilled in the right rear from behind. It's one of those things. It's a hard business for hard people.
It's a tough race, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I love it. You know, we wouldn't be here, any of us, if we didn't recognize the risk and take them with joy. And it's hard to go home like this, but we're here for the race, and we just didn't get very far today.
Okay, then we'll see you at Daytona.
Thanks, Bill.
All right, Randall Ritter had a violent crash here 2 years ago, has come back to enjoy his ARCA competition. We're caution number two at Talladega Super Speedway, back with four in a moment. Back at Talladega Super Speedway, working the second caution flag of the day. Let's check in the pits with Ray Dunlap.
Well, Doc, somewhat of a lucky break for Mike Swaim Jr. He is a lap down now on the racetrack, but he's got his car all in one piece, and this is the reason that he dropped off the pace a few laps ago. He had a hole in the right rear tire. Now, Mike came into the pits, they put right side tires on, and they were going to try to hurry back out onto the speedway to get back on the lead lap, but they weren't able to do that. So since then, they've come back in and put left side tires on, so he does have four fresh tires. Now, with enough laps of caution here in this race today, there are a couple of teams that are going to try to make this a one pit stop race. The 66 car told me before the race started they can go somewhere around 48 laps on fuel. That's incredible fuel mileage. A lot of cars out there can only get about 37 or 38 laps. A big difference. It may be a one-stop race. Here's Bill Weber.
Huge break for Shauna Robinson. Under green before the caution came out, she ran over something on the front stretch. This is her right rear tire, and you can see how it is punctured right here. This happened under green when the caution came out. It saved her. She came down pit road, got four fresh tires, and went back out. Starts at the back of the field, but a very lucky break for Shauna and this team.
And there's a look at the Bob Evans Chevrolet that she ran to in second place finish in Daytona. That car finished second here last year with Matt Hunter aboard. So two second place finishes in that same car owned by James Finch. Getting set for the restart here at Talladega.
Green flag waves as Tim Steele brings them down to the line. Mike Swaim Jr. on the inside, trying to get a lap back from the leaders. Looks like that's going to work very well. He does meet down on the bottom of the racetrack. Just left pit road a moment ago. Didn't take Tim Steele long to get back in the swing of things, coming back to the ARCA division.
You see how right now everybody is almost in a single file group. When they started the race and you're two by two, everybody stays bunched up a lot more. You see those three guys here in the first corner. But once you have the first caution and it becomes a single file restart, they get spread out a lot quicker on the racetrack.
So Kevin Harvick, me like the 20 car, the Real Tree Chevrolet down on the inside, passing some vehicles. Mike Dillon qualified the car, but Kevin Harvick decided to drive, so he had to start at the rear of the field and has now worked his way last time by to the ninth position. Never see Kevin Harvick. Right in front of the Advance Auto Parts of Frank Kimmel off turn four. Check and see what kind of miles per hour that Frank Kimmel will attain. Go down the front stretch, 195 miles per hour. And he drops off down in the corner.
And this is where the car starts slowing down. When it goes into that 33-degree banking, it starts slowing down to 189, and that's about as slow as it gets. And Bobby Gearhart, our Daytona winner, off the pace on the apron of the racetrack, down in 1 and 2, and we can see he's down to 110, 105, and he will only get slower because obviously has no power on this Kuwait Casino Chevrolet.
Up front, four cars, single file. Tim Steele is the leader, but Cicchetti in second spot, Strait, and then Hunter. That's the four. Let's check back in the pits with Brett.
Well, Jerry, Joe Knott just climbed out of his race car. Joe, it looked like after the first spin, everything was going to be okay, but after the second one, you're done. What all happened?
Yeah, unfortunately, I wanted to meet you here today. It's our first time to Talladega with Sharp Racing, and we got involved in that first accident. Guys got spun in front of me, and I got hit from the rear and got spun. It looked like everything was okay, and then I started getting some smoke in the car after we pit and put tires on. And unfortunately, coming off of turn two, it was revving a little bit too much, and it cut down and got me up into the wall. Luckily, it wasn't bad. We're okay. Disheartening day. We're getting this whole deal going. We started last week at Charlotte. We started racing, had an 8th place qualifying, an 8th place finish. So we're off to a great start. Unfortunately, this is the way we want to finish here today. But we're looking for some sponsorship to help us out and get this thing going.
Okay, tough luck for Joe Knott. They have Diamond Ridge cars here that they bought from the Winston Cup team, and he will be in the race at Atlanta.
And I'll say one thing. We talked in the beginning of the show about guys trying to get experience at a place like this. Rookies who have never been here trying to get approved for NASCAR or trying to get approved for the Bushes. Joe Knott's a good example of somebody who comes here for the first time and doesn't realize that if you smell smoke in the car, you got to head to pit road. It's not going to cure itself. It's not going to go away. It's not like it is at some other tracks where it's just because the tire pressure is down. If something's rubbing here, you're running 190. Chances are you're going to end up just like he did in the wall. But he learned a valuable lesson today, and he'll be a better driver because of it.
Riding along with C.W. Smith, Skip Smith, and
Lee. Oh, and you see Tim Steele hard in that outside retaining wall.
Heavy impact. Steele's car leading, goes backwards, up across the racetrack. Cars trying to avoid him. There's Mark Gibson is in the wall, as Steele could not keep his car from coming back down across the 33-degree banks. And here's Gibson coming down across the track, and they will miss him. And there is Matt Hunter in the Ed Renzi-owned Duraloop Chevrolet. His car also collected. So two of the top four cars. There is the leader, Tim Steele, who was the leader.
And the right front damage you see there on Tim Steele's car was made by the 83 car of Matt Hunter's who went by. And there we see poor Mark Gibson came along just as Tim Steele's car came back across the racetrack. And when he tried to dodge it, he lost control. Let's see if we can see what happened on this. There we see right there. It looks like Cicchetti. Yes, he is. The Cicchetti just touches the back of the 16. Gets in the back of him, and up the hill he goes. And right there, those two cars meet head on.
And this is I think this is a left front tire off of the 16 car that's rolling down through the infield. But Tim Steele had a hard impact. He got spun around. One thing that could have cushioned him a little bit and maybe kept him off the wall just a touch was the 83 car. I think he was fortunate that the 83 car. And then you see Gibson come through, and Steele's coming back down the racetrack. Got no brakes on the car because the tires ripped all the lines off more than likely. And he just gets into the fluid and gets into the outside wall. Nowhere that Mark Gibson could go either.
Let's check out Bob Strait's Bondo Mar-Hyde onboard camera. Oh, man, he just got by.
See Matt Hunter's impact. Now, Mark Gibson, Kyle, as the car comes down across the racetrack, Mark Gibson comes there. If he stays straight, he ends up hitting Steele right in the door. So he has to try to avoid it, and he turns the car left and right, and here comes Gibson now. Bryce just does get the car turned to miss Steele's car, but unfortunately it takes him into the wall.
Yeah, you know, Gibson had already committed to where he wanted to be, and Steele's got no control over his car, and as he comes back down the racetrack, Mark Gibson did an incredible job. It's either hit Tim Steele again or hit the wall. And, you know, it's not that you choose to hit either one, but it was a good job by Mark Gibson.
See Matt Hunter standing outside of his car. There's Mark Gibson, the veteran. Mark has 190th, or 82nd, I should say, career start. He leads all active ARCA drivers, and the 1986 Rookie of the Year. There is the crew now, safety crew over there with the Tim Steele machine. Remember, Tim Steele had that pretty horrific impact in testing in Atlanta a year ago, testing with Bud Moore's car during the offseason. So they are in there working with Tim Steele. We'll give you an update as soon as we can on the three-time ARCA Series champion. We are under caution for the third time today, coming out of lap 25. Two of the top four cars involved in an incident up in turns 3 and 4. We'll be back.
Our first full field round of pit stops. Mike Cicchetti, the race leader on pit road. No changes to the car. Four tires, the 66 also on pit road. The 52 of the new champion, Bill Baird, on pit road. They come around to the left side on Cicchetti's car. Directly behind him is last year's champion, Frank Kimmel. He's also getting four tires. These are Hoosier tires, having trouble on the left rear on the 17. The three's racing down pit road. Shelberty will win the battle off pit road, followed by the 17, then the 67, the 22A. Baird will edge him off of pit road. Now they have to push Kimmel to get him away. And a lot of congestion down here on pit road. Shauna Robinson also made her second stop of the race. So a first full field pit stops here at Talladega. We're under caution. A crash involving Tim Steele. Back for an update on his condition and more when we continue in a moment.
Speedway working caution number 3 after a horrific impact up in turn 3 and 4 involving our leader, Tim Steele. Here's what happened.
You can see as they start down into the corner, Tim Steele's leading, but Cicchetti's got a pretty decent run on him. And right about here in the middle of the corner, the 16 car changes direction. You see there's right here, there's two separate angles on the car. 16 car is cutting to the left, the 17 car is still running straight. And as they go, 16 car gets out, the 17 car goes up and just barely gets into the back right rear corner of him, and around he goes. And whether he was going around on his own or whether the 17 gave him a little help, it looks like they got together a little bit. Then the 83 comes in and kind of gets Hutter, or gets into Tim Steele right there. But it's just a wicked hit with the right side, or with the left side of the 16 car.
And we can see where he sheared to right front. It looked like off Matt Hutter's car when he made contact. And we see Cicchetti's car, they made a pit stop, and look at the nose of it. We see no damage at all. So if there was contact between he and Tim Steele, the 16 car, it was just doggone ever so slight.
Now, the good news is that Tim Steele, we did get out of the car. He was awake talking to the safety crew there, so that is great, great news. They put him on a stretcher. We'll take him in to be examined. We'll try to give you an update. But that is great news considering that impact, that Tim is awake and talking to the crew there. Let's check in the pits with Rick.
Well, Jerry, down here at the Infield Medical Center, Mark Gibson and Matt Hutter have both come out under their own power. That's real good news. Mark, when we see this kind of racing here at Talladega, it really is a game of inches. You almost made it through that.
Yeah, I was far enough back, I should have missed it probably, and I thought Tim was going to stay against the wall. So I kind of got in the middle of the racetrack, those cars under me, and he came back down. It was either turn right and try to miss him or hit him in the door. Tim's went through enough in the last 2 years. So I just caught up. This restrictor plate racing, you know.
Well, Tim has, and you have too. We saw you with an awfully hard wreck at Atlanta, now another one here. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. You know, this is two in a row hard wrecks here at Talladega for me. I don't know. The car had a real bad push, and we had dropped back a little bit riding and just get caught up in something. It's, when something happens, somebody's going to get caught up in it, and just happened to be me. So I hope he was okay. You know, he was awake in the infield care center when I left, and he recognized me, so I guess that's good. I don't know. But.
Okay, so Mark Gibson's out also. Matt Hutter, real quick, 2 weeks in a row, tough hits for you. Are you all right?
Yeah, I'm all right. It's a shame. We had an excellent car today. You know, just a real good driving race car, just biding our time trying to break away with a group of four cars there that we thought was a good breakaway deal, and somebody got impatient, I guess.
Okay, well, good news is both of these guys are out and okay.
That is great news, Ray. The 30 car being shown as our leader, well, was our leader. There's Mike Cicchetti in the car 17. Just blitzing by on the inside.
Still there.
He's breaking Brian Ross, the 67 car. Also, Kevin Harvick in the 20 car has moved into the third position.
Well, they are 3 by 3 in turn one. There's Frank Kimmel. Bill Baird, the 52 car, is down there.
Also, our pole sitter, 66 car, Bob Strait. And here comes Kurt Schelmerdine, the most recent winner in the ARCA Bondo Mar-Hyde Series in Charlotte just a couple of weeks ago. I guess that was actually about 10 days ago.
And
And this is the 1999 ARCA Bondo Mar-Hyde Series champion, Bill Baird, we're right along with. He's right along in about the fourth, fifth position. Second in Daytona. She's going by the Dave Steele, the 0-1 car. Dave Steele made an unscheduled stop. He is one lap down.
Back up front, Mike Cicchetti being shown as the leader. Now the second place car, the 67 machine, having off the good run. That's Brian Ross out of Plymouth, Indiana, the Biomet Chevrolet. He's trying to hold off the challenge of the car number 20. That's Kevin Harvick. His first ever trip to Talladega. Yeah, he's out of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, former Winston West Series champion. He'll be driving next year full-time in the Busch Series for Richard Childress.
You know, Cicchetti was getting a really good run because the 0-1 of Dave Steele and the car of Mike Swain Jr., they were both a lap down, but at the lead pack. So they kept the leaders just bound up just enough that in the last time they run them down and went around them. But when they went around them strong, and they kind of checked out on them about 10 or 15 car lengths.
I think that's a good point, Kyle. They had such a run when they went by these cars. They went by so fast, those other cars could not catch on. They were by them and gone before they even thought about pulling over to try to get in the draft.
Sometimes on restarts at places like this, especially at Talladega, being the lead car is not the place to be on the restart sometimes. It's those guys that lag back a little bit in 15th or 16th position, even though you can't pass until you get to the start finish line for the lap. These guys get such a good run on you that you're setting duck at the front of the field, especially when you're on the side.
That's what I was saying in the ideal rod, unless you're the lead dog, the scenery never changes.
That's the way it is at Todd, Talladega. The only advantage of Talladega is if you stay in one place long enough, eventually you get to be the lead dog. You're just not, you may not be there on the right lap, but eventually you get to be there.
The 39 car, Andy Hillenberg. Jim Dandy Dog Food Cart being overtaken and trying to be passed by the 46 of Frank Kimmel.
You see that outside line? Kimmel was right up on him going into turn three, but he got just enough of a run coming off to be able to pull back behind him. Doc Dine, there's Shauna right behind Frank Kimmel. These two, if they get hooked up, she could push Kimmel by him and maybe hook up with the pack in front.
This is a battle for the 9th, 10th, and 11th. Actually, I guess it's 8th, 9th, and 10th.
I mean, you watch Shauna in the one car. This is the same type race she ran at Daytona. She lagged behind there about 6th or 7th, 8th, right along in there. But when it comes crunch time and it comes money time, she's headed to the front. And then she's running the same type of race today that she ran there.
Very smart race by Shauna Robinson. She's in the Bob Evans Chevrolet. That's the car number one, red, white. New rolled the Chevrolet, James Finch-owned car. Mike Swain, the 22, car number 22. There's Shelmerdine, the 3 car.
And the white and green car is Gus Wasson.
Well, drafting is the way to go at Talladega. You got to have a drafting partner. Looks like they got a couple of them hooked up here, Benny, to try to run the leader down.
We're riding along with our pole sitter, Bob Strait. Now, he follows Bill Baird, our champion in 1999, as they try to catch those three. Looking out the back of Bill Baird's car, back at Bob Strait's. The last time by, these cars were about 3/4 of a second behind the leaders. We'll check this time and see, well, we don't have to check. They're right on the back bumper of Kevin Harvick. Now, Harvick moves over. He's hoping that Bill Baird...
This is a tough place to be in if you're Harvick, because this is like your first Super Speedway deal, and you don't know. Do I just let them drive by me on the inside and then let the momentum slow themselves down, or do I try to stay in line? You know, obviously, as we started the race, Tim Steele and a couple of these guys had some fast cars along with Cicchetti and Bob Strait, but obviously, Harvick had a few decent cars that started the back and come to the front.
Gotta wonder what Richard Childress is telling his young driver, Kevin Harvick. We'll take a quick break and come back with more action from Talladega in just a moment.
Kyle Petty, Benny Parsons
right on lap, and Bill Weber covering the action. And here's a cluster of six cars at 190 miles an hour, led by Mike Swain Jr. in the car number 22, the accelerator podium.
And Gus Watson, the 96 car, trying to get on the inside of Kirk Germany. Watson has some drafting help on the bottom with Frank Kimmel. But on the outside is Andy Hillenberg trying to help Shermerdine go by. And here comes Shauna Robinson to close up on the back bumper of Andy Hillenberg. Oh!
You know, the bad part about being in a pack like this is you're sitting back here in fourth or fifth in this pack thinking to myself, if I can just get to the front, I can break away from this pack, or I can lead them. And as soon as you get to the front, somebody comes to the inside of you and gets around you. And we see Shermerdine going to the inside here, making it three wide in front of Hillenberg.
Now we see Frank Kimmel trying to get on the inside of Gus Watson and make it four wide. Wow, almost on the eighth of the racetrack making that pass.
And Kirk Shelmerdine trying to move his way through that pack, and hopefully they'll all get in line so they can catch the leaders. But Shelmerdine's trying to do it with just two tires during that last caution period, just two left side tires on the three car. He gained a lot of track position under the caution, but then lost it when they went to green. He's trying to gain it back now.
By the way, Kyle, the owner of this 96 car, Gus Watson, is Bo Petty. Any relation to you?
There's no telling, man. I'm not famous to Ken or my grandmother or some of that crowd. I got three sisters and a mom and daddy. That's about all I can understand. A couple kids.
Going a little bit farther back in the lineup, we see the white car is... That's Mark Boyd. Was that the fellow that was leading the race just a moment ago?
Yes, it is. I'm pretty sure that's who it is.
The 80 car there is Lazarro. The car that's leading this group is Anthony Lazarro.
Out of Ackworth, Georgia, the Stan Hoover Motorsports Ford. Pretty impressed with him so far, Ben.
Yes. And C.W. Smith, Skip Smith in the 28 car. That is 11th and 12th position. And what really impressed me about Lazarro, when they started the race, he started about 19th, I believe. It was 19th. And he fell back to about 30th because he just didn't feel comfortable in that big group of cars. And now he's worked his way back up to the 11th position. Very impressive young man.
And you know, the one good thing is you've got Lazarro up there running in 11th position, getting some experience, getting some drafting experience. You've got Harvick up there running in third position, getting drafting experience. The only one that's out that we talked about in the first is David Steele, but he's up front with him. Even though he's a lap down, he's up front getting that valuable experience, running with experienced guys. Even if he is a lap down, he's gaining some experience by running with these guys.
And you see this shot out of Skip Smith's car. Skip Smith out of Williamsport, Pennsylvania, is a retired Pennsylvania state trooper. He's accustomed to chasing pretty fast cars, so this is right, he's right at home here.
Hopefully he didn't chase any cars at 190 miles per hour because that's about the speed that he's running right now.
He's a Pennsylvania state trooper. He may know me on a first name basis. I've been stopped in that state a few times.
He did mention you fondly, Kyle.
That's good.
The guy he's chasing, Anthony Lazarro, a Toyota Atlantic champion, now coming to run in ARCA, the Stan Hoover car. These two cars being shown in 11th and 12th position. 46 laps are complete. We're about 11 laps away from the halfway point.
This battle is going on about 15 seconds behind our leader. Our leader still, Mike Cicchetti. Ryan Ross, the 67 car, is still in second, and Harvick is third.
If you're Richard Childress, what would you say to your driver, to Harvick? I mean, what kind of advice do you give him a moment ago when you could talk to him in a situation like this where he's trying to learn super speedway tactics?
You know, the only thing is, like we talked about again, stay here, stay there. You know, you tell him just to stay in line. Just stay in line and follow the car in front of you, follow right in those tracks, and make them find a way around you. Don't pull over and give them that outside line. Don't go high and give them that inside line. Follow that group in front of you. And he's fortunate that he's racing with a pretty good group of guys right there. With and with this group of guys, they're able to break away, and he's only got to worry about three or four guys, and that's what you say. Just pay attention to what's going on. Learn what the car's doing. NASCAR's watching. They're wanting to see him run their single lines, not be bouncing all over the racetrack. They want to be seeing him run high. We did the same thing with Adam last year. We brought him down here. He ran the ARCA race so that he could get approved to run the Busch Series next year. He started taking on some of the super speedways. And Kevin Harvick and these guys are doing exactly what they're supposed to be doing. And that's all Richard Childs is forcing to do. Get experience, get some laps under your belt. Let NASCAR approve you. We don't have to come down here and win the race. You're going to run the Busch Series next year for us, and that's a big deal.
And we see Bill Baird going by there. Now we go back to the next big group of cars, and they're still together. Shauna Robinson, the one car, the 46 of Frank Kimmel, led by the three car, Kurt Schoenemann. The car at the end of this line, Mike Swain Jr. The yellow and black car is a lap down. Also, there's Andy Hillenburg in the 39 car. And there goes Gus Wasson. That is the cars running 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Looks like Gus Wasson about to get shuffled out of this pack if he doesn't hurry up and catch up.
A lot of times when you get in the position that Gus Wasson's in right there, you're praying that you run side by side just for a half a lap or so, so you can get called up, because that's what happens. A lot of times you get in a pack like that, all of a sudden they get single file and you're the odd man out and you get shuffled.
And we go back to the lead. 1, 2, 3, 4. These guys lined up just trying to get away from these other cars. So as the race progresses down, they've only got to race 2 or 3 cars, not that big pack of 10 or 12.
As we approach the 50-lap mark at Talladega in the Winn-Dixie 300, Mike Cicchetti is our leader, Ross Harvick, Strait, and Baird, the top five. RPM Tonight comes your way each and every night, Monday through Friday, 7 Eastern Time. John Kernan and all the staff at RPM getting up to date on what's happening in motorsports around the world. RPM Tonight, Monday through Friday at 7 Eastern Time. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, Go.com.
Back to the lead. They're still lined up, but there is a change. The 66 car, Bob Strait, has moved by Kevin Harvick for that third spot.
And I'm going to say something. When Bob Strait moved by Kevin Harvick, Kevin Harvick's had a lot of experience and really a lot of experience almost to have no experience. He eased up. He let the 66 get back in line, and he eased in behind him. He didn't want to spend a lot of time running side by side and lose a lot of ground in his first two. And the way it worked out, he's able to hang on. He only lost one position. He didn't lose the tie.
Lucas Oil Telemetry, the world leaders in heavy duty and high performance lubricants, bringing us telemetry here. And Vinny will take a look at this this car's speed in the draft.
Well, right now he's getting shuffled back to the fourth position.
Back up in line there, buddy. Go on, get up there.
That's exactly what I was thinking. Get back in line, follow these guys. Back up to 190, 191. Now as he goes down in the corner, down to 188, as he goes down the backstretch, if this thing is going to catch up, which it should, he was our pole sitter, we ought to see some speeds a little over 190 miles per hour. 192, 193. Now he drops it off down in the corner, and we can see him just closing up. Look at 194 as he drops it off down, as he goes down the hill, down into the third corner.
This car really drafts good. You saw how far he was behind as he came off this corner last time. And within a lap, he's made the move. And you see, the 20 car does the same thing here. He's eased up. And this time, he's going to close the door on him. Last time, he eased up and laid him back in line in front of him so they wouldn't do this. So they wouldn't end up running something.
Right. Ride for a little while.
Now, they keep talking to Bob, telling him to stay in line. But he, with a car like he's got that drafts up so well, I think a minute ago he ran up on the 67 car and got caught on the inside, and they went around him to the outside.
I think that's what I think. When he ran up on the back of the 67 guy, he came out of the throttle just enough to let Harvey get that run on the outside. And here with these restrictor plates, if you ever back off that throttle, it takes you about a lap to get the car back up to full speed.
And see the bottom there where it says brake? You don't see the lights come on at all. You don't have to worry about your pedal until you come down pit road, huh, Kyle?
I tell you what, it's surprising. You see it. You run this stuff, especially in the Winston Cup, when they run in a pack, you'll see the brake a lot, because instead of lifting off the accelerator and closing the carburetor up and having to jump back into it and create that flow again, a lot of the Winston Cup guys just bind the car up with the brake and stay wide open and they jump off of it. We've gone from running super speedway brake setups to running short track brakes on these cars because you use so much brake during the day trying to stay off of people.
Plus, if you play with the throttle, you can burn a piston when you change and when you lean out the motor a little bit here in a tight draft.
And you set your car up, you know, and you set your car and you'll see these guys out get plug checks and leave the plugs and stuff like that. You do all that in the draft. You don't want to be running by yourself. If you get caught at Talladega running by yourself, it doesn't make any difference if you got a 286 or a 291 or 94 or 300 gear. You're dead in the water. You got to have some kind of pass. So you set up and you pull the car straight in the draft the whole time.
Joe Nemechek, our pole sitter for the Winston 500 that will be run here tomorrow. Just like Kyle Petty said, if he were to get
feel good, comfortable, Bobby,
by himself, it would only take about 15 or 20 laps until they would come around and lap him tomorrow. You have to run with draft and help. And there we see Bill Baird, the fifth place car. We see what an advantage they have on that. That is 14 and a half seconds. And one thing that's keeping Bill Baird going is the car behind him that's drafting along with him. It's Ron Cox, I believe, that's following Bill Baird. You see what kind of speed that he's running down the backstretch? About 4 or 5 miles per hour slower than Bob Strait. When he drives it down the corner, we see up to 196. We saw Bob Strait up to 194 a couple of times.
You see the difference in RPMs, too. You see 6,700 RPMs coming up out of the corner with those guys at 187, 188. Well, we've got a car in the wall right here.
And the car up against the outside concrete wall, bringing out caution for the fourth time today on lap 58. And the car basically ground into the concrete up there, and he's not actually up on the bank, more into the trial area, so he's not in the 33-degree part of the course rather than the 18 degrees. So that is the car number 97 of Doug Reed.
I think he hit the wall up in here someplace, but now he's finally come to rest just as the car exit off turn four.
So Doug Reed out of Hewittown, Alabama, a car they brought here that is 14 years old. They've been bringing this car here for about 5 years. And here's what happened to the local Alabama native, the car heavy impact.
And when this car stops, folks, it stops because it gets tired of rolling. It certainly isn't anything the driver does to make it stop.
Caution for the fourth time today here on lap 58 at Talladega Super Speedway. Back with more in just a moment. Corner of the day here into the fourth caution flag of the afternoon. Let's go down to the pits to Ray Dunlap.
Bob Strait is in the 66 car, Jerry, and I think it's going to be right side tires only. They're going to try to do this to get the car out quickly. They're going to work on it. Now to Bill Weber.
Mike Tricchetti is on pit road. He's in the 17 at the top of your triple pits. He's supposed to get four tires. The 66 car is already on his way. Long rim on the right side for the 17. He is going to take four tires. The 66 maneuvers his way out of traffic and heads down pit road, followed by several cars. Meanwhile, the left side's going on the 17. Away. Right behind him, Kimmel still sits on pit road. As Baird escapes the traffic and leaves the pit, the 46 is away, the 20 and the 1 of Shauna Robinson all off pit road together.
Boy, a near miss between Kevin Harvick and Shauna Robinson exiting the pits there. You saw Bob Strait, his pit stop only 13 seconds, just two tires.
Just two tires trying to get that track position.
All right, pit stops have been completed. We'll see how it sorts out when we come back as we work the fourth caution flag of the day here as the laps continue with the Winn-Dixie 300. Back with more in a moment. Speedway working caution number four on the afternoon. Now, speaking of battles, we got one coming your way. The Friday Night Fight presented by Budweiser from the Orleans Casino and Resort in Las Vegas, Nevada. This week features a 12-round USBA Championship light heavyweight bout. The champion, Will Taylor, taking on the challenger, David Telesco. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, go.com.
Take a look at our pit summary after those most of the lead cars came down pit road. And, Benny, there were some significant losers here.
Well, see, Giacchetti was the leader. Comes out in ninth spot. Ross back to 11th. Harvick all the way back to 14th. Bob Strait went in fourth, came out fourth. The three cars right now that won, the cars that run 1, 2, 3 did not pit. But I think that was a mistake for Strait, just changing two tires. Kyle, if you get a chance on a caution flag to change four tires, you try to take advantage of it.
You try to take advantage of it, especially if you've got a car that's capable of running in the top two or three like his car is. You don't want to give up any opportunity to give that other guy a little bit of an advantage. And I don't know how these tires are wearing because we're not down there walking through the pits and looking at them as they come off. But if I had an opportunity at this point in time and I was running third and fourth to put on tires, I'd have put on four.
And we are being told Andy Hillenburg also just changed two tires. He's been shown in fourth position. So we'll see what the two tires will do. And particularly, you're concerned about some of the tire wear. We hear that maybe Doug Reed, he brought out this caution flag, indeed cut a tire, cut a right front tire. So they're concerned about the tire wear. And let's check into their pits on the fuel situation with Bill Weber.
And, Jerry, that's going to be the big question here in the final 50 laps or so of this race. As Ray had talked about earlier, a lot of teams getting very different gas mileage in this race. Several of them hope that's their last stop, but they're going to need between, say, 5 and 10 caution flag laps to help them get to the finish. Shauna Robinson can make it to the last lap, but probably will run out of fuel on the last lap if there are no caution flags between now and the end of the race. So fuel mileage down the stretch, very critical. A lot of guys can't make it. Looks like one girl might be able to.
How about that for Shauna? We'll see how close it comes as we get set for the restart here on lap 64. The caution out for a total of 5 laps. And the car number 40.
Green.
The white car, Dan Partis, is the leader. The yellow car in front of Partis. A lap down. That 22 car, the yellow and black car on the inside, still trying to get that lap back. He lost with a punctured tire back early in the race.
This is the same type scenario we had a minute ago, where the first two or three cars are a lap down, or maybe two or three laps down. They're running too wide, trying to get out there and trying to go, but it opens the door up because of the way they do for the fast cars, like Bob Strait right here on the outside of Partis, to sweep through here and make some time.
You watch Bob Strait begin to make a move, see if he can pull Partis with him, the 42 car. 50 laps to go in Talladega. Benny, you were talking about it. Oh, here's Giacchetti making a move down almost on the apron of the racetrack.
My Giacchetti radio.
And here's what Benny and I were talking about. It's easy to sit up here and make look at what they do on pit road and say, well, I wouldn't have done that, or this wouldn't have done, or whatever. But there's Giacchetti running second with 4 fresh tires, and Bob Strait right in front of him after 1 lap with 2 fresh tires. So you would think that you would rather be in that position with 4. I know I would, but maybe Bob Strait and his crew have a different plan.
Caution flag will bunch them up in a hurry here at Talladega. Inches apart, they're drafting by at 185 to 190 miles an hour just laps ago. 12 to 15 cars just a few feet apart here at the 2.66 mile super speedway.
Frank Kimmel trying to work his way through as he follows Brian Ross. There's Ross in the 67 right alongside Andy Hillenburg. Now, Kimmel has a 20 car of Kevin Harvick right behind him, giving some drafting help as they try to get on the inside of Ross. Can't quite make it. Ross's car goes in the corner, goes up the hill, gets it back under control.
Ross's car almost looks like it's a qualifying mode. When you get to looking at it run through the corners and stuff, the way the rear of the car is down, like he's running an incredible amount of rebound in the rear shocks. Pull the rear down, you see it bouncing, and it's just a real rough ride compared to some of the other cars that are out there.
Kimmel gets a great run off the corner, tries to pull alongside Ross. 3 wide. right in the middle of the back stretch. Harvick trying to follow Frank Kimmel. That's Kimmel, the red number 46.
Oh, and the 67 spins.
He loops around. Shauna Robinson back there. She was trying to avoid him as cars come down across.
Turn 3 and 4. Caution, caution.
And Shauna was not able to get by. The car spun right in front of her. She was collected. As here come the leaders, Strait, Cicchetti, and company back to the line. Mike Swain trying to get his lap back, will not be able to do it. His caution now is waving for the fifth time today.
You can see the damage to Shauna Robinson's, Bob Evans, Chevrolet. She may get back on the racetrack, will certainly not win today. We see her unbuckling, starting to get out of the car.
And she had absolutely no place to go, Kyle. She's sitting back there in the draft, a couple of car lengths back when this car decided there was contact. And this car, Brian Ross, loops around. There's some of the damage in the front of Brian Ross's car. Now Shauna fires her car, and she talks to the safety workers, and they tell her that the damage isn't that significant. And she'll head back to pit road, and Mark Reno, the James Spence crew, will try to get this car repaired, at least to be able to finish the afternoon.
Yeah, she may be able to finish, but it's just like you say, there's no chance to win. She's not running for points, and there's the only thing you can do is put that Bob Evans logo out there in front of everybody to see, but that's about it. You see these guys go in the corner. It's like the 67 didn't see Harvick here, and as he gets there, if you look at the lines on the racetrack, boom, there they are. They touch. Harvick's as low as he can go. You see the car get out from underneath, and as the car spins, Shauna's got no place to go. He spins right dead in front of her. She goes to the high side, he clips. She goes up, did a really good job of her turning the car and getting back down off the racetrack. These guys, they were right in the middle of a pack right here. So everybody did a really good job to be limited to two cars.
And there you see the cars right there making that almost contact, if not contact. And you're right, I don't think Brian Ross realized that Kevin Harvick was coming along with Frank Kimmel. And there's a contact, and the 32 car, Mark Stahl, just barely gets by the one of Shauna Robinson before she spins back down off the racetrack.
And Andy Belmont also making an evasive move, and Ted Kennedy, the double zero car up there as well.
See Brian Ross with the right front tire flat as he comes down pit road.
All right, caution for the fifth time a day at Talladega. Scary moment. Brian Ross spins. He collects. Shauna Robinson back in a moment. Let's check in the pits with Ray Dunlap.
Well, Jerry, Shauna is out of the Bob Evans Chevy, but there's a good bit of damage on the left front there. I guess you're done for the day, right?
Yeah, unfortunately, we're done for the day. It wasn't the way I wanted to leave Talladega, that's for sure. We had a really good race car with the Bob Evans Chevrolet. And, you know, they always say you got to race like it's your last race, and it's definitely what I was doing here. But we were in a situation where there was nothing I could do. The car just lost it in front of me, and I tried everything to miss him, but it was just a little too close. But it's unfortunate because we had the car, and we had a tire go down early in the race and set us back. So I was fighting all day, really, to get back up. And once I hooked up with Frank Kimmel, we were definitely moving and picking a draft up. So we were going to eventually get to the front, and I feel like I definitely had the car, and there was no chance there was a chance. So. It's unfortunate because, you know, all I want to do is race, and hated it ended short.
Yeah, well, that's all there is. Same car that they had at Daytona where she finished second, but they're done for the day.
Tough break for Shauna Robinson. Now, there's Bob Bissinger, who is the crew chief for the pole-sitting and current leading car of Bob Strait. And there is a spotter, Joe Ryan, up on the roof. Now, we have what we call an ARCA spotlight, where you're able to listen in on the communications between, or among, I should say, the spotter, the crew chief, and the driver.
Gotta stay focused on this restart now. Been getting killed on these restarts. We're good to go to the green, to the checkered flag. And we can't let anybody by. Just stick with what you've been doing. Let's just do it a lot better. Let's not change the game in the middle of the game because we're not sure. If we could have done that earlier in the race, we might know. Joe, let's work with him real good here. Let's talk to him a lot. Let's give him a lot of information so he can make positive moves. We know Cicchetti's going to be coming like a gangster up through there, so let's get our jump on him. Let's get out front.
And Joe they're talking to is Joe Ryan, the spotter we saw on the right side of the screen. These guys want to win this race, don't you, Kyle?
These guys want to win bad. And, he's talked all day long. There's Joe Ryan. He's a spotter, also the motor builder, I think. But These guys have really talked all day long about staying focused and being on top of things and getting the most out of the game.
You saw Don Strait, who is the brother of driver Bob Strait, who's actually the co-crew chief down there along with Bob Bissinger. You heard Bob Bissinger talking a moment ago in our ARCA spotlight. Getting set for a restart here on lap 72 of 113, which make up the Winn-Dixie 300.
Cars on the right side of the screen. Cars that are lap down. Five cars down there led by David Steele in the 01, the track phone car. Straight bringing the car slowly down, waiting for the flagman to wave the green flag. It is waved, and they're accelerating back up, hopefully to 190 miles per hour.
Showing the way, Cicchetti in second spot. Now two cars begin to pull down and make their way on the inside of the racetrack. Kurt Shelverding's the car number three, the 46 car. That is Frank Campbell, the 1998 ARCA champion, with Kevin Harvick right behind him in the 20 car.
This is the, along with Bob Strait, we're riding with him, the pole sitter. The ARCA Bondo Mar-Hyde onboard cameras. He looks back at Cicchetti. Now Cicchetti has Frank Kimmel right on his back bumper. Both these cars change four tires. And Bob Strait only two. How will that play out as we get down near the end of the race? As Kimmel got by the three car of Kurt Shelverding just a moment ago, the 20 car of Kevin Harvick was not able to slip by. He's still back there struggling, trying to get by. He finally does move into the fourth position. Now he has Bill Baird, the 1999 champion, that will close on his back bumper. Maybe those two cars can hook up and draft to the front.
It's going to take a couple of cars hooking up to get back to those first three. But like you said, Harvick got caught on the inside of Kurt Shelverding. Couldn't go anywhere, and within about a lap and a half, they had stretched out far enough that they broke the draft. And once they broke the draft, then the second pack really started to bunch up because it just began to bottleneck at the front.
Never seen the 80 car, Anthony Lazarro. A great run he has going today as he closes it right on the back bumper of Kurt Shelverding. He's currently running in the eighth position. Baird on the inside of Harvick trying to take the spot away.
See, these guys are doing nothing right now but hurting themselves as far as running down the front pack. It's almost like they run. You want to tell them, get in line, stay in line. You're fast enough maybe to run down that front pack, but every time you get a little bit of speed, they bunch up 2x2, 3x3, and the front two or three guys check out further.
And that front pack is Bob Strait in the 66 car, then Mark Thompson on Midway Island Ford. Behind him, Mike Cicchetti. And behind Cicchetti, the Advance Auto Parts car is Frank Kimmel.
Tommy, just run your race.
The radio transmission just a moment ago was the Bob Strait pit crew talking to him as he went by them.
Side that's really bunching them up behind this group for third spot. Cicchetti makes the move to the inside, and Strait will cover the position. Less than 40 laps to go at Talladega Superspeedway in the 17th running of the Winn-Dixie 300. Bob Strait continues to be our leader. Back in a moment. 300. There's our lead threesome. Bob Strait, the leader, the 66 car. Behind him, Mike Cicchetti. And behind him, the 1998 ARCA champion of Frank Kimmel. Crew chief and spotter both watching anxiously as Bob Strait, the 50-year-old veteran. That's Don Strait, a left side.
I'd rather be up front with them dicing around.
I think
discussion ongoing down in Bob Strait's pit. Now, Frank Kimmel, the big concern about his fuel, he has leased for the first time this year a Hendrick engine. They have a Randy Dorton engine in the car number 52, so,
yes.
Or 46, so they're concerned about fuel because of all the horsepower.
Because they have no idea exactly what kind of fuel mileage they're going to get as compared to what they've been racing.
But you heard him say, those SB2s make gas, you know what I mean, which means that they're not going to use as much gas as these two Fords are, is what he's thinking in his mind. So he thinks Kimmel's got enough gas to go all the way. They're trying to get everybody to believe that Teddy's going to run out of gas at some point in time.
I love the conversation between Don Strait and Bob Bissinger, the two co-crew chiefs. Said, do we know Cicchetti's going to run out of gas? Said, no, but we can start the rumor.
Negative.
Just 30 laps to go.
30. 113. Yeah. That's what I got told is 113.
Yes.
30. 30 laps to go. 3-0 laps to go.
Boy, Kyle, you begin to question even how many laps are in the race at this point.
They don't know who's going to run out of gas or who's got enough gas. They don't know who's making gas or who's not. They don't even know how many laps are left. But he took charge. You saw him. He said, no, that can't be right. And he goes over and he asks. He's got two people in his pit, so he counts laps. So he did a good job to get it back under control.
Now we saw the interval between Kimmel, who's third spot right there, and the fourth place vehicle right now is Andy Hillenburg. He was 2 seconds, and in five laps, you see they've increased it to 4.5 seconds. Look at Kimmel, every lap, 50.3, 50.5, Storsman was 50.7, and Hillenburg back there had one lap at 51.5. There, see the red car on the left is Andy Hillenburg, followed closely by Kevin Harvick, then Dan Pardis. Of Skip Smith, that white car at the very tail end, still out there running in seventh position.
Mike, how's your water now?
Mike,
along with the roof camera. CW Skip Smith out of Williamsport, Pennsylvania, the Shopback Raceway Stores Chevrolet. CW finished seventh here at Talladega back in October of 97. So also had a pretty horrific incident at Atlanta a couple of years ago.
A yellow car, there's Robert Burrows out of Mississippi. That's hanging with this group of cars. Now going by some traffic. Oh, let me see Kimmel. I mean, Bob Strait all of a sudden drove down and tries to break the draft of the Ducati car. That's not going to work.
No, not with these guys behind him, especially running in tandem like that. You know, if you're trying to break the draft from one car in front of him, it's possible that you're trying to leave back and forth and break it a touch. Not a lot, but break it just enough to keep him behind you. But if you get two guys running in tandem, chances are you turn to the left, they're going to go by you on the outside running wide open.
That's what I was thinking.
Well, what about the fuel strategy? Let's check into the pits with Bill Weber.
Well, I can help you out on a couple of cars. First of all, Mike Cicchetti definitely cannot make it. He can only get to about a lap 105, so they're trying to figure out their strategy at this point, but they know they can't make it. As for Frank Kimmel, they don't know if he can make it or not, but they're not going to stop. They're either going to win or run out of gas. So that's the formula for the 46 car for the final laps. Down pit road, here's Ray.
The story in the 66 pit, Bill, is that they can go the distance, no question about it. They last pitted on lap 60, so that leaves them 53 laps to go. They could not do that if it was all under green, but they have not all been green flag laps. So with the caution laps, all the guys down here in the Midway Island group are confident that Bob Strait can go till the checker.
Well, my experience with Whistling Cup crew chiefs on race day is if they can go all the way to tell the driver, we can make it. If they can't go all the way, they tell the driver, we don't know. They never tell him that he can't make it. So, yeah. And we'll find out as the laps are winding down at Talladega Super Speedway. Bob Strait is our leader. Back in a moment.
The absence of discipline.
The laps beginning to wind down now in the Winn-Dixie 300. Bob Strait continues to lead the Midway Island Ford. Now, a lot of discussions ongoing among the crew members here in the Midway Island pits, the Phoenix Air pits. There's Joe Ryan, the spotter. As we will eavesdrop now on the communications among Joe Ryan, Bob Strait, and Bob Bissinger, the crew chief.
As 20 cars moving through the pack, if he gets in front of that train, he may be able to pull them up a little bit. If they get the Dyson around, who knows? I'd rather be up front with them Dyson around.
I think Frank's got it figured out right now. If he goes with Cicchetti,
Bobby goes with him,
and
he's at the point.
He
cut that deal. He cut the deal with the devil.
All right, discussions, huh?
Cut the deal with the devil, huh? Bob Strait. Now, the 17 of Ducati, he's tried to pass a couple times. He's looked low. He's tried to get Kimmel to go with him, but so far they've not been able to gain anything at all on the Midway Island number 66 of Bob Strait.
You see the 17 going to the inside, to the outside. You see him running a lot of different places.
This time by 20 to go.
And Gus Wasson has just blown the left front tire.
And there is no caution flying as of yet. Hank Wetzel being talked to by the ARCA spotters around the racetrack. Gus Wasson's car down on the very apron of the track, out of the groove. You continue to see these three cars, nose to tail, about a car length and a half separating the three of them. Straight. And ARCA saying the track is indeed clear. There's no debris being shown up in the groove, so we stay green.
A tough look for Gus Wasson. Got a good run going.
But you know, the one thing you got to be a little bit concerned about right there, that's a left front tire. And the 66 car, Bob Strait, didn't change left. He's going to have a lot of laps on these lefts with 20 laps to go when this thing is all said and done.
Doing a good job, Bob. Get good smooth rest. Keep going.
Joe Ryan talking to Bob Strait. You got to believe that there's any report of debris. It's the guys who need fuel that are reporting it big time.
Oh, yeah. Anytime I'm running, and I need a caution because the leader's coming up or something's happening. I start screaming on the radio, but they never pay any attention to you.
There's animals on the track.
Yeah, I'm seeing things out here. I hadn't had any sleep. There's an elephant in the middle of the backstretch. I got to have a caution.
And they're talking about the 20 car, and obviously he would be the guy screaming the loudest for debris right now because Kevin Harvick is back in fourth spot, but he's a little over 7 seconds behind this leader, Bob Strait.
And what I was going to say a minute ago, the 17 will jockey to the inside and he'll move to the outside, and he keeps juking around, messing with the 66, but he's still a car length and a half behind him. If he was right up on his bumper doing something, he would have an opportunity to make him move and pull out and have Kim come out of somebody in that wall coming out of turn two over there.
Got an incident, 00, Ed Kennedy, the Coppell, Texas driver in a Chevrolet Monte Carlo.
Car down the back straightaway, up against the wall, Mike. Hard to get out.
And here goes Shumberdine.
Danny Partis and Shelmarine involved in an incident trying to get slowed down. They slide across the racetrack down in turn two.
Back off a little, Bob. Back off. You should back off some.
And we see the radiator, the fluid out of the three car means that he's broken the radiator on that car. Now then, who's going to be making the pit stop? Who's going to be changing tires? What about fuel? What about tires? Well, now
down,
we'll find out.
All right, we'll check and see what's going to change. Ed Kennedy's car contacting the wall, bringing out caution for the sixth time. We'll come back and check on strategy in a moment. Back at Talladega Superspeedway, the late laps of the Winn-Dixie 300. I'll show you again why we are under caution for the sixth time today, involving the 00 car, Coppell, Texas driver, Ed Kennedy.
Black and gold car comes off turn two, and all of a sudden the right front tire goes flat, and bam, hard in that outside retaining wall. Once again, we'll show you just how quick this happens. He's going straight, and in the matter of just a split second, he's in the outside wall.
And while this is taking place, Penny, there's another incident about to take place.
Robert Burrows, the yellow car, goes down in turn one. We see some smoke from the brakes when he tried to slow down. He runs in the back of Dan Partis in the 42. Partis spins back across the racetrack, right in front of Kirk Shelmerdine, has no place to go, and both those cars out of competition.
And there is take a look at Ed Kennedy out of Coppell, Texas. A little wobbly, but able to walk away to the ambulance, thankfully, bringing out the sixth caution flag of the day as we are approaching 10 laps to go. Now, we've been following some of the discussions on pit road. There's a look at the Phoenix Air team, the Bob Strait crew that Bob, of course, is our leader. So we'll check in with them. We'll get another ARCA spotlight and eavesdrop on the conversation.
I understand that Cicchetti's coming in the pit. Let's make sure we watch that pit, make sure he doesn't lower the car or anything on us, okay? Hang
on. Mickey, right there.
Mickey, run down to Cicchetti's pit, watch pit stop lowering the car. Okay, Bob, that last restart was perfect. Now we're going to just get a carbon copy of it this time to go, and we'll be in good shape.
And there you see Cicchetti going on pit road.
I think Kimmel's going to be behind you on this restart, so we'll have to see how that goes.
All right, let's go check in with Bill Weber in the pits.
Okay, we'll see if we can update you on all this. Cicchetti had to pit, obviously, because he didn't have enough fuel to get to the finish. So he came in and he got fuel. He also got right side tires, but because there's a tire rule in ARCA, the tires he put on already had 20 laps on them because they'd used up all their sticker tires. So no one else came down pit road. That put Cicchetti at the end of the field. Then they gave the one-to-go sign. Well, as the cars were getting into position, Cicchetti was working his way through traffic, and here's where things start to get a little foggy. But somehow, Mike Cicchetti and Mike Harmon got together on the racetrack. Apparently, as Cicchetti was trying to get through the field, he thought Harmon was a lap car. He tried to go around him. Maybe Harmon didn't want him going by, but anyway, they made contact. Harmon ended up in the wall. So now his day is over. Cicchetti has left front damage. He came back down pit road, got new left side tires. They pulled out the sheet metal. They put on tape, and they sent him back out to the end of the field. So he went from running second to running at the back of the pack with left front damage, and he's got four tires, but they're old tires. And his promising day has turned very disappointing because of some wacky developments down the stretch here.
Boy, Bill, and we have less than 10 laps to go, and you got a feel for Mike Harmon. Here, Mike Harmon running in 11th position in the R&B Steel Chevrolet, minding his own business and under caution, ends up spinning into the wall, ends up getting a tank.
We'll see the pace car about to go off the racetrack. We'll be going back to green. Green flag is waved, and we'll have 9 laps to go to decide this thing.
Around Talladega Superspeedway, the wind
50-year-old Bob Strait, our pole sitter, Midway Island Ford, the Mark Thompson on machine. He is the leader. See Kevin Harvick back there laying back, trying to get a good run on this start. He might have started a little bit too early.
The only thing worse than starting late is starting too early and then having to check up again.
It looked like he might have started just a little bit too early. Time winner in ARCA competition, but take a look. He has never won on the Super Speedway. Incredible. This 50-year-old ARCA veteran hoping to get his first ever Super Speedway win here today. He's got to hold on for 8.5 more laps.
Now the 20 car, Kevin Harvick, the real free Chevrolet from Richard Childress Camp, looks like he is just barely hanging on to these front two cars. On the right end of the screen is Anthony Lazarro trying to get a good finish on his first battle. Makes some contact, and Bill Baird, the champion, spins, slams the wall. Lazarro head on. I think it's C.W. Smith that meets him head on.
That indeed is Skip Smith involved, the 28 car. There's Lazaro's car number 80, the Stan Hoover machine, still sliding on the inside. More cars spinning, and they're still crashing. At least a half a dozen cars involved in an incident here on lap 106, and they're still sliding. Caution flag today, and there is the Saturn machine Chevrolet. That is the ARCA champion, Bill Baird. You see his onboard camera showing you he is getting unhooked, getting the gloves off. Let's show you again what happened as Baird was trying to make a pass, and they were three wide.
And we see Lazaro is right down the bottom of the racetrack, and right there, they just make contact just enough that both cars spin. The Andy Hillenberg goes up, makes contact with the outside retaining wall, and there's Lazaro just gets hit head on with a Skip Smith number 28 car. Let's ride along with Bill Baird and check this thing out, Kyle.
Yeah, as you watch him go down the backstretch, Baird runs up on him, and all of a sudden, boom, we're three wide. Look at the lines on the racetrack, or as the camera scan. Right here, he gets hit. He's going the wrong way. But if you can... This was right in the middle of the pack that was running 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, right there. They were going for 5th position. And these guys continue to go up the racetrack. A lot of fluid on the racetrack right here.
Here's Skip Smith. Let's watch as he meets the 80 car head on.
What's the 80 car here out of your window? Look at it get up in the air. If you watch that camera angle again, the 80 car goes down across the flat and then lifts up into the air and slams down on the racetrack right as Skip hits it.
It's almost like just one roof flap came up on the 80 car.
The 80 car's right here. He goes around. He goes out of your picture right there. Man. But there's a couple of different angles where the 80 car is actually off the racetrack.
Now, here's a shot that Kyle, you're talking about. And watch down the very left-hand side of your screen at the 80 car.
Watch him right here lift. He is up in the air right there.
And you do not see that. Finally, the roof flaps deploy, but you do not see him come up when the car began to come up off the ground. That's unusual.
Yeah, that's very unusual. But most of the time, the roof flaps take off, and they keep the car on the ground, but that car didn't have a chance.
And there's the veteran Norm Benning out of his car. We'll set who all was involved when we come back to Talladega in just a moment. Back at Talladega Super Speedway, still working the 7th caution flag of the day. 7 cars involved in an incident up in turns 3 and 4, and because of so many cars involved and so much debris on the racetrack, we are still under caution. They have waved the white flag. This is the final lap. Here's what happened just a moment ago on lap 106.
See the contact between Bill Baird, the 52 car, Anthony Lazarro in the 80. And watch as Lazarro gets up in the air and gets hit head-on with C.W. Smith, Skip Smith in the 28. And then about six or seven other cars are involved as well. We see the 17 car, Mike Cicchetti, right there, gets run in the back off by Mark Stahl.
Well, the race isn't over yet, but we do have crowned the champion today, right, Bill?
And that would be Bill Baird, and under certainly unusual circumstances, congratulations on your 1999 championship.
Well, thanks, Bill. You know, it's we had good, didn't have the best car here, but it wound up running good at the end, and it's first DNF this year, so it's, but we had the championship wrapped up for the year, and it just hadn't sunk in yet. I'm still ready to go racing, and I just killed me walking out of that car a while ago, but hey, we won it big, and it's nice to have the championship behind us with still one more race to go.
Dream come true for you.
It is. I mean, you know, I've been racing 10 years, and actually this year was the first year I ever won a race, and won five of them. I think we had 4 or 5 seconds and 3 or 4 thirds, and been outside of, had DNF this year, and the first car we really tore up, so I can't complain.
Well, congratulations to Bill Baird, the 1999 series champion. As for the race champion, let's check in with Dr. Punch.
And the fans are on their feet cheering for 50-year-old Bob Strait from Mokena, Illinois. Driver of the Midway Island Ford, and there's
the get by him there. Run him on up there. Good job, Bob. Congratulations on your first Super Speedway win.
What a job by that crew, Joe Ryan.
Now remember, you got to stop at the end of pit road.
And the engine builder, he's reminding the driver, you got to stop at the end of pit road. They got to check that spoiler, minimum 60-degree spoiler. And how about that young man? That'll be a, well, he's a young man. He's just 50 years of age, BP, right?
Real young man.
He's the winner of the Winn-Dixie 300. His first, as you heard a moment ago, ever Super Speedway win. His 15th career victory. And we'll come back to talk to the winner of the Winn-Dixie 300 in just a moment.
52 of Bill Baird. The 39 car, Andy Hillenberg, goes up, hits the wall. And we see all the other cars making contact. So Lazarro, high in the air, comes back across the racetrack. Skip Smith in the 28 meets head on.
And here's the race winner, the Midway Island Ford, the Mark Thompson-owned car for 50-year-old Mokena, Illinois veteran Bob Strait, spinning donuts on the racetrack. And we did indeed crown a champion today. How about this guy, another 50-year-old, 1999 ARCA national champion, is Bill Baird. For Kyle Petty, Benny Parsons, Ray Dunlap, and Bill Weber, I'm Jerry Punch. Once again, congratulating our champion, Bill Baird, and today's winner, Bob Strait. So long, everyone, from Talladega, Alabama.